The hills are alive with the sound of haters. Hey! iPhone 13 Pro Max. Let's discuss. Hey there, friends on YouTube. My name is Jason, and this is Painfully Honest Tech. Tech so honest it hurts. If this is your first time here, thank you for stopping by. I hope you'll come back again. And if you've been here before, thank you so much for being a painfully honest part of the Wizard Squad. If you would like to be a part of the Wizard Squad, yes, you. I'm inviting you to be a part of the Wizard Squad. Hit subscribe down below. Today, we are going to talk about the iPhone 13 Pro Max. Now, this is kind of the tale of two reviews. On one hand, this is a very impressive device. There's lots of cool stuff that goes on. On the other hand, this is a device that is not too dissimilar from the device that came before it, the iPhone 12 Pro Max. They're not that different. So it's becoming harder and harder to review iPhones. As I've said in other videos, I did a video on the iPhone experience versus the Android experience. It'll be linked down in the description below. You can go check that out after this video is over. It'll be linked at the end of the video as well. But it's fun. It's a fun video. Everybody loves it. And in doing that video, I discussed the fact that the value of the iPhone is really in the overall experience that the iPhone lets you into. It's not just the phone itself that makes the difference, but everything that the phone can do. So I'm going to talk about this phone in terms of the phone itself, build quality, screen quality, all that kind of stuff, the five pillars of a great smartphone, as Marques Brownlee once said. And then you can decide whether or not it's worth you picking up an iPhone 13, 13 Pro Max, 13 Pro, 13 Mini, whatever it is. So first off, the build quality on this thing is, there's just nothing that's not great about it. I know that seems hyperbolic to say. I know that seems like I'm fanboying all over the iPhone, but the fact of the matter is, Apple has been doing this for so long that these phones just, they are completely locked down when it comes to the design and the build of the phone. This new squared-off design that started with last year's phone, with the stainless steel rails along the sides here. This is a smoked stainless steel that matches the back color pretty much. Then the frosted glass on the back, the Apple logo that's kind of unfrosted inside the rest of the glass. Just the feel of this phone in the hands. Now, I do wish that the stainless steel rails maybe had a little bit more. They didn't get greasy like this. Since the back of this phone doesn't get greasy anymore, it's just so nice to touch. And so the stainless steel rails are kind of gross. The iPhone 13 and the iPhone 13 Mini have aluminum rails that are sort of more of a matte finish, and that would be nice here. Although, I mean, the bling of the stainless steel rails can't be denied. Although it only blings for a second and then you're done. In terms of the screen, I mean, here we are again. I don't know what it is with the glass that they've put on the phones in the past couple of years. I did not use a screen protector on my iPhone 12 Pro Max. And looking at this in the light here, I'll shut it off. There's not even like a hairline scratch, maybe a little bit of one right there. I remember when I got my iPhone 8 Pro, I guess it was then, or 8 Plus. I remember when I got that and it slipped out of my pocket in my house and hit the wood floor, which of course wood is not that hard. And I picked it up and it had a scratch. I mean, I just had it for an hour. So the screen durability didn't used to be all that great, but I've never seen a scratch on the back of one of these phones. I've never seen a scratch on any of these flat screens. And that is not to say that they can't break. I mean, obviously they can break. In fact, my wife, who has a 12 Pro Max, she dropped her phone while cooking and it hit at just an angle from not too high up that she ended up having a screen protector on, but the screen protector didn't break. The glass underneath did. And so that's kind of a drag. I have to get that fixed. Overall, I found this iPhone to be incredibly well built. There's a nice heft to it that always sort of connotes a very premium build, And the materials on top of that, it feels great. The experience of using the phone in terms of how it's built, very, very good. So I've got no reason to complain about the build. Apple has always done great with build quality. Over the years, they've used better and better materials. The materials have gotten better and better. The iPhone 13 Pro Max is just, you know, another iteration of a little bit better than it was before. Even this ugly camera hump that we all complained about when it first came out has grown on me. Because when I saw it in renders, it was kind of like, oh, it just looks so ugly. But they've done this nice thing where they've taken the matte finish, like sort of swooped it up the sides of this raised glass portion, and then the raised glass portion is a clear glass. You can kind of see back through to the finish, and then the lenses just look really, really fantastic. It becomes a design feature. I mean, that's sort of one thing that Apple does well. They take things and make them into design features. Some people might even expand that out to the notch. And as I've been talking about the iPhone 13 Pro Max, and as all the iPhones since the iPhone 10, people have been talking about the notch. And this year's notch is smaller. Let me see. But here's the problem. I use my phone exclusively in dark mode, and maybe you can see it a little bit there. The only way that I am ever going to see the notch is if I do this. And then I'll see it. But I lose too much of the picture in doing that, so I always just leave it in this sort of letterboxed mode. That's the only way I'm ever going to see the notch. Otherwise, I can't see it on my home screen in any way that impacts my use of the phone. It just is a non-issue, and I want to encourage everybody to realize that since dark mode became a thing, and I think a lot of people use dark mode, I certainly do, and my eyes have thanked me for it. Since dark mode has become a thing, the notch has become less of an issue. It does not impinge upon my viewing of the screen almost at any time whatsoever. And if it does, I don't notice it, so I guess that's okay. They made the notch smaller this year. That's good. That's a build feature, I suppose. But I just want to say that the notch is not really an issue anymore. And since we're talking about the notch, we might as well move on to the screen. The screen is something that has been much discussed this year, and it was much discussed last year because Apple did not include last year a 120Hz screen. While most of the Android flagships had at least gone up to 90Hz, most of them had gone to 120. I want to try and illustrate the difference between 120 and 60Hz. This is a 60Hz display right here. This is 120. So we'll go over here to the app libraries and we'll swipe back and forth. Now, with the way that Apple's animations work, it doesn't really look all that different to me. Now, where it's really noticeable is when you go into something like this and you scroll the text. You can see that the text on the right side is blurry as you move through, and the text on the left side is staying nice and crisp. That's the one place that I can see the 120Hz. I'm not a big gamer on the phone, so that doesn't really impact my experience, but with text is where I really see the 120Hz working. It's nice that it's there. This is an adaptive refresh rate down to zero and all the way up to 120, depending on what you're doing with the phone. A lot of content is not in 120Hz if you're talking about videos or things like that. It's a good feature, but it's not a make or break feature for me. I know that I'm going to take a lot of hate in the comments for that, but it's not a make or break feature for me. The one thing I can say about the screen beyond the 120Hz on this phone is that the colors just seem to pop a little bit more than they do here. I don't know if it's going to come through on this camera or not, but the color of this Apple Music widget is much a deeper, sort of more vibrant version of the color than this is. And it's a small thing. I think if you were using the iPhone 12 Pro Max, you would not notice a difference. So, but I do notice a difference side by side. It's just a very nice looking screen, and along with the 120 hertz, it's probably the best screen that Apple has put on a smartphone, and for my money, one of my favorite screens that I've looked at. Now we move on to battery. Battery is kind of where the rubber meets the road with smartphones these days. Most flagship and even like mid-level phones have pretty decent battery life these days, and that didn't used to be the case. Battery life used to be one of the places where smartphones really kind of struggled, but in the last couple of years, Apple has really stepped up their game. They came up with some way to make the battery last longer. I don't know what it was, but since the iPhone 11 series, the iPhone batteries have been best in class, longest lasting batteries that I've used on any phone. So last year's 12 Pro Max was a battery champion. I never had to worry about it running out in a day. I barely get past 50% in a day. And the new iPhone 13 Pro Max and the iPhone 13 both get 2.5 hours more battery life than their predecessors. And the iPhone 13 mini and the iPhone 13 Pro both get 1.5 hours of battery life. The iPhone mini is the one model last year where the battery struggled, and it was kind of an issue with an extra 1.5 hours of battery. That should make that version of the phone much more reliable. But overall, I have not been able to kill this battery in a day. I have not been able to get it below 50% all that much in a day. I got up at 6 o'clock in the morning, and of course my phone is the first thing that I pick up because that's just how it is. I'm at 79% on the iPhone 13 Pro Max, and I've been using the phone all day, kind of just testing stuff and getting ready to do this review. So the battery on these things is just in another league altogether. The 12 Pro Max was better than anything last year. This is better than anything this year. I don't think that you're going to find a phone that has better battery life, unless it's one of those rugged phones that has like a giant battery on it or something like that. You're not going to find better battery life on a flagship phone this year than on these iPhones. And that's really saying something, since Apple was not always the leader in the battery category. And now we get to the camera. Now, every year, Apple has a little trick up its sleeve, and over the past few years, it's been the camera. And so the camera this year has been improved significantly in a couple of ways. For one thing, we have better wide-angle lens with a better f-stop. It's, I think, f1.8 instead of over 2, if I recall correctly. Better telephoto, better main camera. Overall, they've just taken what was good about last year's camera, made a few tweaks, and made it better. The ultra-wide camera was really a struggle for me last year because I tried to use the ultra-wide to do some video, and it just really didn't work. This year, it seems like it's going to be a different story. It goes to 3x zoom instead of 2.5, and it still goes down to 1.2. Doing the macro thing, there's a point at which it macros. So here we are, and then it gets down here, and you see it switch to macro mode. Switched back, switch. It goes macro, and then you pull back, and it pops out. So there's just a little animation there. And macro mode is my favorite thing. So let's try that with the iPhone 12 Pro Max. And you see, it doesn't get into macro mode. And it just won't pull focus there. That's about as far as you can get. This is where you start to go into macro mode with the iPhone 13 Pro Max. And this camera just can't do it. I'm using the same lens. I didn't really know how much I wanted macro until I did want macro. And so now we have macro. The other big thing about the camera this year is what they're calling cinematic mode, where you can focus on different things. And some people are just saying, oh, it's just portrait mode for video. Right now I'm focused on my ATEM. I want to focus over here. I want to focus on this. I want to focus on this. And you notice that everything just switches. The focus pulls from one place to the next. And it just does it in a really interesting and satisfying way. Cinematic mode will work automatically when you have a bunch of people in a frame, and it'll choose which person is looking at you. But you can also go in, it'll choose which person is looking at the camera and rack the focus from one side to the next and that kind of thing. Cinematic mode is a high-level technique used in film. Usually, in order to do it, you need to have some more pricey equipment. That's not something that everybody can get. So Apple is once again taking a high-end feature. Last year, they brought raw photos to the iPhone. This year, they bring the cinematic mode to the video side, and they're also bringing ProRes video, which will make professional-style raw, quote-unquote, video on the iPhone itself. Every year, Apple kind of has that one thing that they really tweak, and it ends up making a really solid argument for buying the phone if that's something that you really care about. And that if is a big if. Let's go on and talk about performance, and we'll finally round it out with my recommendations on whether or not you should consider buying the iPhone 13 Pro line. Again, the iPhone has always been super smooth. Apple has taken this operating system, all the animations, all the opening of the... Everything on this thing never skips a beat. The A14 chip is such that you could probably use this phone for the next 3 to 4 years, 5 years, and never notice a hiccup in the performance of this phone. And that's one thing that Apple kind of has over and above any other manufacturer. There are people who are out there with iPhone 6Ss who are upgrading to iOS 15, and their phones are still performing relatively well. I know that a lot of people say, oh, when Apple releases a new phone, they slow down the old phones. And they have done that. But Apple, as a rule, has always produced phones that perform incredibly well, to the point where the performance is so fluid that it's not something that's on your mind. It's no different here than it has been on previous models. And in fact, given the level of performance that Apple's been able to get out of their M1 chips, both on the iPads and on their new MacBooks and Mac Mini, I can only see the performance of the iPhones sort of just exponentially ramping up to the point where nobody's ever going to catch them. They're already above and beyond anything that Android has in terms of Snapdragon chips or anything like that. Not to say that those chips don't perform well, because they do, but the iPhone is always more powerful. Benchmarks show it, usage shows it. It's just the way it is. And again, it's not a slight to Android. Android phones perform incredibly well. There's a lot of really great performance that you can get on all kinds of different Android phones. And that in itself is something that a lot of people appreciate about Android. When you buy an iPhone, you're buying an iPhone with kind of the assurance that performance of the phone will never be an issue. You're going to get your updates of your operating systems. I mean, the iPhone 6S came out in 2016, I think, and it still gets the latest OS updates. And so that's how many, the 6S, the 7, the 8, the 10, the 10 Pro Max, the 11, the 12, now the 13. That's a lot of phones that still are receiving updates, even years and years, 5 years plus after Apple release the phone. So performance is never going to be an issue with an iPhone. You may prefer something different than how the iPhone performs, but that's a different conversation. Now we get to the good stuff. Should you buy the iPhone 13 Pro Max, Pro, 13 regular, 13 mini? A lot of people are saying if you have last year's phone, you don't need to get this year's phone. A lot of people are saying if you have the 11, you don't need to get this year's phone. And all of that is true. The fact of the matter is nobody needs to get this phone unless the phone that they have is totally broken. Nobody needs to get this phone. Can I recommend you buy this phone regardless of whether or not you want or need it? Yes. This is absolutely, once again, the best iPhone that Apple has ever made, and the improvements are such that the 120Hz screen makes it a better experience with the screen. The screen itself looks better. Cinematic mode and ProRes and just the macro mode and everything that's going on with the camera are really great. And then, of course, you have the performance and the build quality. It's all there. Do I have something negative to say about this version of the iPhone? It's boring in the sense that it's pretty similar to last year's iPhone, but there's enough that separates it between the iPhone 12 and the iPhone 11 that it does make an argument for itself whether or not it's worth purchasing. If you're an iPhone person, you will love this phone. If you're not an iPhone person, you'll feel the way that you feel about iPhones, regardless of what I or anybody else says. If you need or want a new phone, if you buy a new phone every year, if you've broken your phone, if you have held on to your iPhone 5S until now, no matter what, this is a worthy upgrade, regardless of where you are. It's everybody's own decision whether or not it's time for them to make that upgrade. I'm glad that I did. I do every year, and this phone has not disappointed me so far, and that should be the case for you. Anyway, thanks so much for being here. I really do appreciate it. Once again, my name's Jason. This is Painfully Honest Tech. Tech so honest it hurts. Jazz hands. Until the next time, I'm out.